everybody, all of the many, many people. Okay, there's nobody here, but. So I'm going to talk about 3D printing in Linux, and I'm going to give you an overview about what 3D printing is, and then I'm going to talk about how you can go from an idea to the physical object with free and open source software, and then talk about some of the hardware that's out there for 3D printing and the various support of it from Linux, and some other options that are out there if you want to do that sort of printing on Linux. So to start with, 3D printing is the process of making a three-dimensional solid object of virtually any shape from a digital model. The most common method of 3D printing is when you're doing something that's additive. So basically, you're taking a material and you're adding it in layers on top of a material. This is different from traditional shop tools, which rely on subtractive processes, where they're either cutting or drilling or lasering out something from a material. It's not a new technology. 3D printing is something that's been around since the 1970s, and it's only been in the last 5 years that the cost of 3D printing has dropped significantly because of patents expiring in the space. And so it was possible for people to build their own implementations without having to worry about having to pay the prohibitive patent costs. And as the patents started to expire, people felt brave enough to do this. And so while there were 3D printing previous to 5 years ago, there were certainly people that were doing it in violation of patents and building things up, like the early people doing the first generation RepRap stuff. It's only been recently that it's been sort of consumable by people that are not already really well-versed in shop tools. So there's lots of different ways to do 3D printing. The most common method is what's called fused filament fabrication, or FFF. Now, you might also see, if you look on the internet, this is called fused deposition modeling, or FDM. But that term is trademarked by Stratasys, which is one of the big 3D printer manufacturers of proprietary printers. And so I don't like to use it, so I'm gonna keep using FFF. Now, FFF is when something, there's a lot of different ways of doing this, something is driving the source material, which is usually a plastic filament, into a heated nozzle. And so the heated nozzle melts that material and extrudes it as either a small bead or a small line. And the width of extrusion is controlled by the diameter of the hole in the nozzle. A lot of designs also have a small amount of tanking, where the nozzle is melting the material and it's being kept in sort of a tank reservoir. And then as pressure is applied down in, it's forcing the material out of the tank that's already being held in the liquid state to keep a constant flow going through the printer. Sometimes that's done by simply having the nozzle be shaped like this, as opposed to being shaped like this with a tiny point at the end. Sometimes there's actually more of a tank in the design of the extruder. The nozzle then moves horizontally, vertically, making a layer, and then moving up, which is what's on 3D printing is called the Z-axis, and printing another layer until the object is complete. And so you can imagine that it's printing a layer, moving up, printing another layer, moving up, and so forth, and so on. Now, there's a couple different types of materials that are commonly used for this style of printing. Acrylonitrile butadiene styrene, which is commonly known as ABS. This is most familiar to people because it is the plastic they use to make Legos out of. Now, they do not 3D print Legos, though you can if you wish. You can't call them Legos because then you're violating the trademark, but you can call them stackable bricks. ABS is strong plastic, and that's why people use it. When they make Legos, they do a molded injection model where they inject the plastic into the mold and out comes the Lego bricks. It requires a high nozzle temperature, about 230 degrees Celsius for most ABS mixes to get a reliable print out of it, and it usually requires a heated bed to get a good adhesion for the first two layers. The downside of ABS is that it's not terribly environmentally friendly. It smells like burning cancer when you're printing with it. And you're not going to fool anybody if they see you printing with ABS. They're going to be like, oh, man, that has a smell. So there's another option, which is PLA. PLA is polylactic acid. PLA is biodegradable. It's biofriendly. It smells like pancakes when it's printing. Some people say it smells like syrup or pancakes or a mix of pancakes and syrup. It is derived from renewable resources and not oil like ABS. Sometimes we see people mixing it with PHA nowadays, which is, I'm going to have to look at this, polyhydroalkanoate. PHA is also biodegradable, but when you mix it with PLA, it improves the strength of PLA and gets it closer to the strength of ABS. So if you're buying PLA from a vendor like ColorFab, they're going to mix PHA in there to make that PLA stronger, and it still has the same rough melting point. PLA's melting point is slightly less than ABS. It also can be printed on printers that don't have a heated bed, though if you do have a heated bed, if you turn it on low, you'll get a better result out of a PLA print in general. Now, when the manufacturers make these plastics, they produce them in pellet form. It's the standard form for plastics. You can't really 3D print a pellet. Although I did see a printer once that was 3D printing with pellets, it was just 30 feet tall. So what you want to do is you want to be able to take those pellets and then turn them into a string of filament. And you want that filament to be of a consistent width. Now there's two standard widths in the 3D printer industry. One of them is 1.75 millimeters, the other is 3 millimeters. My printers use 3 millimeter stuff. A lot of printers that I don't own use 1.75, so there's still both are being widely produced to help the market out. Cheap filaments out of China are going to vary widely in quality. Sometimes they're going to have air bubbles in the filaments. Sometimes they're not going to be the consistent width, and you're going to get bad prints as a result. Sometimes they may not actually even be the material they sold you as it being. I have bought a couple of spools on discount on Amazon from China that said they were ABS, but when I got them back, they printed awful, and I said, why is this printing so poorly? And a friend of mine said, it's probably not ABS. And he said, have you tried dissolving it in solvent? And ABS dissolves in acetone, which is nail polish remover. And so I took a sample of it, I put it into acetone, and 3 days later, it was still sitting there sticking out of acetone. It's not ABS, and that's why it printed like that. So buying good quality materials, it definitely has an improvement on the quality of your prints. If you're not spending $40 to $50 on your ABS, you're not getting good ABS. You can get PLA, good quality PLA, for $30 to $40 US. And that's not to say that you won't find a deal on good quality, you know, sometimes, but in general, if you're paying less than that, you're not getting a good result. Now, there are some less common materials that also work with FFF. High-impact polystyrene, when it's not colored, it will print translucent. It's also pretty good because it prints at roughly the same temperatures as ABS, and it's a little easier and a little smoother. It has a bit of a sheen on it, so people like the look. The downside to high-impact polystyrene is that if you print something large on it, the bottom will literally burn, and you can see the char marks on the bottom layer. So for small things, HIPS is great for introductory printing, but for big things, you end up having to paint the bottom because it's got to burn. Polyvinyl alcohol, PVA, is nice because it dissolves in water. PVA is basically just glue stick, and it's very tricky and finicky to actually print with. But a lot of people like printing PVA on a dual nozzle printer with PLA as the main material because the heating points are roughly the same. And then you can have the supports in the model, which I'll talk about later, be PVA. And then you can throw the whole thing in a bucket of water and leave it overnight, and the PVA will mostly dissolve and you'll be left with the plastic. T-glass prints almost clear and has the right capacity to act as a light pipe. So a lot of people use it for printing specifically light pipes for electronics, so that if you want your LED on your Raspberry Pi to start on the board and then come out the other end, you print this little pipe and you put it in your case, and then when it's on, it comes out the other side. And then there's a new material called Eastman Amphora, and Eastman Amphora is like ABS, but a lot stronger. And so it doesn't shatter or delaminate like ABS can under tension. If you have got one of the bags, the green bottle opener that Lulzbot printed that has the Fedora logo on it and the Flock logo, that's actually printed in Eastman Amphora, and they did that specifically so that it wouldn't delaminate or shatter when you went to open a tough bottle.
I noticed they were opening your bottles last night.
Yep. Yep, it totally works. Yep. Now there's even some more unique materials that you can use for FFF. There's nylons, there's a number of different nylons. Nylons are very finicky to deal with. You have to usually be very experienced in doing these to get them right. You want to put down a lot of stuff on the bed. A lot of people who are doing 3D printing use tape. There's a number of different kinds of tape that you can use to help that first layer stick. Nylon won't stick to tape, it won't stick to glass. The tricks for nylon are usually to actually spread glue stick on the bed and then bring it to heat, and then you might have a better chance of having the nylon stick, and it still might not. There's a nylon called Bridge that was released in March of 2014, and that tends to print better than a lot of the other nylons. Since then, the company that makes most of the nylons has made a couple more that are really reliable in printing, with varying degrees of why you want to print that. Some people like to do crazy things, like try to run edge trimmer line through a 3D printer, because functionally that's just a plastic line. The biggest reasons why you wouldn't want to do that are it's not set up to be good for 3D printing. It's inconsistent in width. The materials that are in it are whatever was cheapest that month at the plastic factory. So some people have reported success with it. I don't recommend that path. Labrick is actually a stone filament. The company that makes Labrick basically takes stone, pulverizes it to dust, mixes it with a plastic solvent, and it all gets stuck together, then they string it out as a filament, and when you print it, most of the plastic gets burned off, and you're left with majority stone dust. So you have an object that has the feel and texture of stone. It does not have the same strength as pure stone, but for printing little models or toys or things that want to have that stone look and feel, you can use Labrick. The same is true for lay wood, which is just wood pulp mixed with the same plastic. When you print it, most of the plastic burns off and you're left with the wood. You can actually do fun tricks when you're printing with the lay wood where you adjust the heat during the print to print grain into the wood model. NinjaFlex, which is a thermoplastic elastomer, is a new material that came out about a year ago. There's also SemiFlex, which is another material. They're flexible plastics. They have the same basic qualities as a rubber. And if you have a printer that is able to drive forcefully enough the filament in there without clogging, you can actually print out these flexible items. The Lulzbot TAS printer has a special add-on that the open source community specifically designed to do nothing but this flexible material printing. And so it can do very reliable prints with this. If you try to print it on other printers, there's a whole internet sort of sub-community of people that are desperately trying to figure out how to hack their printers to reliably print the flexible stuff. It can be done, it's just a little harder.
Did they do that for the Mini too?
The Mini doesn't currently support the flexible materials out of the box because it doesn't have the interchangeable head unit, but they're looking at figuring out if there's an easy way to add that in the future. They haven't done that yet.
Is this a extruder thing? Or
the flexi extruder.
Flexi extruder,
yes. Now, this is my Lulzbot TAS. This is actually the TAS 3. It's a few generations back. Printing at Red Hat Summit 2014. Sadly, it's the only video I have of my 3D printer actually printing something. Most of the time, I just take pictures of the fails that it finishes at the end. But it's printing some Fedora logos on the bed there. So it gives you an idea of what it looks like when it's in action. Now, how do we get to that point? 3D printers are not magic. You just can't go to the printer and be like, print me a puppy. It's not gonna do that. It doesn't know what you're talking about. And in general, 3D printers are really stupid devices. They don't have a lot of intelligence. They basically are expecting someone to tell them, move my motors like this at all times. And I don't know what I'm doing, I'm just doing what you tell me. And so when you talk to a 3D printer, you have to send it an explicit list of instructions for it to do with its motors and its thermocouplings and bring it to this temperature, turn the fan on to this speed, move my motors this much. So what we have to do is we want to start with an idea. Okay, I want to make a puppy. Great. So the first thing you're going to have to do is generate a 3D model of your puppy. Now, there's a couple different ways you can make a 3D model. You can use visual CAD tools. In the proprietary world, this would be things like SolidWorks, AutoCAD, anything that has the capability of doing more than 2D CAD. In the free and open source world, we have things like FreeCAD and LibreCAD. They're not awesome, I'll be honest, but they are showing progress. Both of them are in active development. They both are adding different features, and so what I have found is that people who have experience in CAD look at one and go, nope, not doing that. They look at the other one and they're like, well, that's almost as good. That's the right sort of tool. So it really boils down to what type of tooling you've learned on, what you're comfortable with. So try one. If it's not good, try another. There are some other lesser known CAD tools out there in the open source community, but most of them have been abandoned and they don't have active development going on. There's also 3D animation tools, so things like Blender, which are designed specifically to let you create 3D models for the purposes of rendering them for animation. And they work great for 3D printing as well, as long as you remember that you can create 3D models that your printer can't actually print. And it doesn't matter in the Shrek universe if Shrek has air gaps and weird holes inside of the model that the printer then tries to interpret and doesn't know what to do with. So in general, if you're using a tool like Blender to make a 3D model, you want to look for the number of tutorials that are out there on the necessary steps to take your model, which looks good in Blender and renders great on your computer, and then making them 3D printing. The key word you're looking for there is usually watertight. You want to make sure that the model in Blender is actually watertight.
There is a very great series of video tutorials from, I don't remember his name, sorry. It's on Blender website. It's using Blender specifically for 3D printing stuff.
Yeah.
You have actually to buy it, but it's Creative Commons. And it's really very good. So if you like Blender, and if you have used Blender before, also if you haven't used Blender at any time, you can learn how to design 3D printable models.
Now the last tool is the tool that I tend to use most of all when I'm creating models, which is OpenSCAD. OpenSCAD is a programmer's interface to CAD, where you literally write a program, and then you hit the compile and render button, and it shows you the 3D object that gets built as a result. So you can call functions for specific operations, additions, subtractions, merges, unions, modifications, move, layer, shrink, grow, scale, all of these are functions that exist in this programming language that's sort of a pseudo C language. And then you write your program and it generates the result. So most of the models that I've created, which is not a ton to be fair, I've done with OpenSCAD. Or you can use an existing model. There's a large community of people on the internet that have been uploading models for things they've built and putting them out there under permissive licenses. Some more permissive than others. The two big sites that are out there for open source friendly models are Thingiverse, which is kind of open source friendly, and BLD3R. BLD3R is sort of a people that were angry at Thingiverse went and created one. They said, well, we're going to do ours completely open source. Everything here is going to be either open source or Creative Commons. It just doesn't have as many models as Thingiverse does. Thingiverse has a much larger universe of models. There's also a lot of other sites that have models that aren't open source but are free to download. Things like My Mini Factory has a lot of really high quality models that people have uploaded that are free for download. Some of them are actually Creative Commons, but the vast majority of them aren't. Now, some 3D models are not printable using an FFF printer without having to do all sorts of special games. Now, FFF printers print from bottom to top. This means that when you have what's called an overhang without a gradual change in degree, you're effectively trying to print in thin air. So to visualize this, let me stick my arm out. If I was attempting to print myself in this representation, my arm is overhanging thin air. It is not a gradual overhang like this, but rather a very sharp overhang. And so when the printer gets to about here, the printer doesn't realize that it can't print in thin air, the nozzle will move out and start extruding plastic in thin air. This results in spaghetti, any number of terms for utter print fail when you have just the sea of extruded filament in thin air. It will not result in the model you expect. So what you can either do is design a model that has a gradual change, that doesn't have these explicit overhangs, or which you know generally is when you can do a smooth or a gentle curve, you can make the arm sort of curve out or whatever it is that's overhanging, or you can print with support. And so most of the tools will take your 3D model, detect your overhangs, if you tell it to, and then add support material underneath it. So in my case, when my arm is out like this, it would generate a mesh of support that the printer then prints up to that point, and then when it gets to the point of printing the arm, there's a layer of plastic meshing that would hold up the actual solid piece that I want. Then when you're done, you either break off or cut off the supports and are left with the final product. So that resolves the problem, but there's a lot of post-work you have to do on the piece, and if the details are very intricate that require the overhang, it's very easy to snap off or cut off the thing you were trying to protect with the mesh on the overhang. So you have to be careful with the model. Now, we've got a model, we want to be able to turn this into layers. when the FFF printer is printing, it needs to be able to print a layer, one layer up, next layer up, next layer up. So we need to slice the model. Now, when you slice, you're going to be slicing to your specific printer. You can't slice to the universe. It depends on the type of printer you're using, the size of the nozzle you're using, the size of the bed, the G-code specifics for that printer. So you want to go ahead and have your slicing tool ready and configured for your printer before you start slicing models. This is why people don't generally share G-code for their models and instead share the actual 3D object before that. Now, the standard file format for 3D printable models is STL. The 3D printer doesn't know how to speak STL 99% of the time. They speak G-code. G-code is the rough equivalent in 3D printing to PostScript. It's a set of machine instructions that tell the printer, do this, do that. If you have any shop equipment, your shop equipment talks G-code as well. Now, slicer programs take the STL. They allow you to set the options you care about, shrink it, grow it, duplicate it, do all these things, and then say, okay, now slice it to G-code. And then you can slice all of that code into something that your printer will understand and you can then give to the printer. The most common open source is Slicer, with a 3 instead of an E. Slicer is a giant pile of Perl. It is somewhat notorious for being slow, but working pretty well. It just revved a major version recently. And the new major version has a lot of interesting new features. It is still under active development. A lot of really smart people who understand math way better than I ever will are adding a lot of really interesting things to the Slicer environment to try to both improve performance and add interesting features. One of the interesting things that went into the new Slicer is when you're printing a 3D object, you don't need to print solid plastic in the middle because no one's ever going to see that. You just want it to be strong, and that's generally it. And you can adjust what's called infill, the plastic in the middle, and say, well, I'm going to print less of that. And you can turn the percentage of infill down. If you turn it down to zero, it will try to print a hollow object. Some models will take a hollow object. Some models, you'll end up printing in thin air if you try to print a hollow object. So the trick is always, for most people, is to minimize the plastic that has to go into the infill while maximizing the strength of the model so the model doesn't collapse on itself or fail to print. So one of the things that went into the new Slicer was a new patterning for infill that minimizes plastic, but the geometry of it is such that it has a structure that is super strong. It looks weird, the layout, when you look at it, but the infill inside of it, it uses a lot less plastic at a great strength. So you can choose that type. I tend to not be so fancy with my infill. I tend to just tell it to do cross, and then the other way, and then this way, and then the other way. There are some people who do honeycombing, that's been around for a while, and again, you can tweak that for your model and your preferences. There's another slicer that's built into Cura. We'll talk about Cura a little bit later.
You see, most of the slicing part now is C++, and it's generally much faster than it was a year ago, so there is no more speed problems, I guess. The interface is still a huge bunch of very bad Perl. I've sent it some patches and it's very bad Perl, even if it's Perl, it's usually very bad.
But you're right, and I think I've timed even the new Slicer versus Cura, and I think Cura still beats Slicer in every test I've run against it, on speed. So
probably, but it's still like so little time that it doesn't matter anymore.
It depends on when you're slicing giant models, which is what I'm usually throwing at it. When you're slicing really big models, it's evident. Slicer still takes about 45 minutes if it doesn't die, and Cura will still do it in about 5.
I remember when we sliced models like this on Golem, on Skeinforge.
Yep.
It took like 3 days.
Oh, Skeinforge, yeah.
And we needed 60 gigabytes of SSD as a swap to actually do that.
Yeah, the slicer, the Skeinforge slice tool that no one should ever use ever again, but existed before Slicer did. Yeah, some ugly code. Everyone that looked at it, I was like, oh, I'm going to improve it. They ran away screaming. So now we've got our G code. Now we need to print. So there's a couple different ways you can do this. If you want to control the print from your computer and your printer is connected directly to the computer, you can use printer control software. PrintRun is one that's out there that's been around for a while. Cura is another one. Cura actually has its own slicer code built into it. It was originally built for the Ultimaker printers, but it is open source, and so Lulzbot forked it for their printers, and a number of other people with specific RecRot family printers have been using it for their printers as well. There's also Repeteer Host, which is out there, but only version 0.9 and older are open source. The upstream for Repeteer Host after 0.9 decided he wanted to make some money off of this and proprietarized all the features that he added after that. So it basically took most of his community said, well, we're not going to use your stuff anymore, and got away from it and stopped using it. So there is still Repeteer Host out there for Linux, but it's not open source and we don't ship anything newer than 0.9. Now, this control software basically just establishes the connection to the printer. 99% of the printers I've seen show up as a USB serial device. Sometimes they detect incorrectly as a modem and network manager tries to build a connection to them. It's pretty easy to tell network manager not to do that. You just have to tell it to, no, that's not a modem. You don't need to try and dial it out.
Do they make a 300 baud modem squeal when they do it?
The printer may make an awful noise, but I don't think it actually does anything. And then once that connection is established, then the software sends the G code across the line to the printer, and the printer buffers it sometimes, depending on whether it has any flash or not. Some of the cheaper printers literally are taking G code line by line across the wire and printing that way. And then if anything happens, that printer's going to fail. Sometimes they buffer it onto an SD, sometimes they buffer it into flash. The smart printers at least are doing some buffering of the G code. Usually they're sending it across once, holding it, and then printing the entire time. That still doesn't mean you can disconnect your computer and walk away, because sometimes that will cause the printer to lose its mind and stop working. A lot of printers can print without being connected to a computer. They'll read an SD card that's plugged into it and read the G code off of that and print it. So the nicer printers will have an SD card slot, and you can put your G code on that SD card and print directly from it, and then you can take your computer and walk away. If your computer locks up, you don't have a failed print. You can also do manual motor and temperature control via these connected programs by sending the specific G-code instructions across. One of my favorite tricks that I have done in the past is to write a series of G-code that makes the stepper motors move but not extrude any plastic or heat up. This causes the printer, which makes a lovely whine for each that is slightly different for each of the stepper motors, to play a little song. So I can make my printer play the Tetris music, which is kind of special. When the print fails, the printer actually does the hardware shake. It's different. Now, the print goes, it sends the instructions off, and again, the printer is stupid. It is literally just, I move here, I extrude this much plastic at this temperature, I move over here, do it some more. It really has no concept of what it's done before, it has no concept of state. If you pause the print and hit the extruder or knock it over or shift it slightly and then unpause it, it'll be like, I'm still going, it just happily just keeps doing its thing. And so it's really easy for printers that aren't calibrated well to get out of alignment during the course of a print and fail as a process of that. And so a lot of people who build their own printers spend a lot of time struggling with this because they don't have their belts tight or they don't have good calibration. And the printer doesn't know it's doing anything bad. It's just like, I'm doing what you told me. Now, after the print is done, you have to remove the print from the bed. Now, some materials need to cool first, or when you try to get them off, you'll warp them and tear them and shatter them. The most common mistake that people make when they start 3D printing with ABS for the first time is that second that print goes, they go at it with their little razor blade or their knife to get it off the bed, and it bends off the bed, and you end up having this, well, one of my legs is bent up like this because that's how I pulled it off the bed. You really want to wait for ABS prints to cool a little bit before you start attacking them and getting them off the bed. Small objects usually don't show warping, but even on the little Fedora logos that we printed, when you get under them when they're just done, they peel up. PLA tends not need that much of a time. It doesn't need to cool too much before it comes off the bed. PLA will usually come right off when it's done.
If it's thin and large, like that, like a little flat surface, mm-hmm. and it's hot, you literally just like peel it off like a yogurt,
yeah.
and it's going to be hurt. But if it's like a normal size object, it's fine.
That's true. Now, all FFF printing, even at the highest resolution I've seen, results in visible layering. Even when you're maxed out, you can still see the layers on the print. Now, if that bothers you, and most people who are doing 3D printing are not terribly bothered by the layering, but some people really want that smooth look. They want to know how to smooth the print. So there's a couple different ways of smoothing a model. One thing you can do is you can usually brush on a thin layer of the solvent for the material and smooth out the layers a little bit. You're actually melting the plastic when you do this, but if you're careful, you can do it. There's a couple different techniques to do do this for ABS specifically. ABS is nice because the solvent is cheap, easily accessible, and you can literally go to any drugstore and get it. It's nail polish remover.
And it's pretty good for your health.
Yeah, it's good to smell it. It's also slightly flammable, but you want to be careful. Don't throw it on an open flame or anything. So the two tricks are, there's two methods that are out there right now for doing acetone, which is nail polish remover, smoothing of ABS. One is heated smoothing, where basically the method that the way I describe this is you take a glass bell jar, you take some aluminum foil, and you make a little stand, and you put the stand inside the jar, and then you put your ABS object on top of the aluminum foil stand, and then you pour ABS into the bell jar, not onto the object, but underneath the stand, and then you put the whole contraption open on the top onto your heated bed of your printer, and you turn the heat on the heated bed. The acetone heats, it turns from liquid to vapor, and the vapor smooths out the top of the jar, comes out the top, and passes the model in a relatively even manner, and then it smooths the model. Now, if you leave it in there too long, you won't have any model anymore, it'll be gone. If you leave it in a little less than that, you'll have a drippy model that looks like, you know, Salvador Dali painted it. But if you leave it in there for a short window of time, and then you take it off the heat, what you'll end up with something that looks very smooth, it looks almost extrusion molded. The other mechanism of doing it, if you're not fast, is to do cold paper smoothing, where you take nail polish remover, you soak some paper towels in it, you line the inside of a Tupperware container with the paper towels, you make your little stand, you put your object on the stand inside this container, you put the lid on it, and you come back 6 hours later, and it will have eventually, enough of it will have turned into gas to pass across. And this is, people tend to prefer this one if you're willing to wait, because you get much cleaner results and there's much less likelihood that it will turn into a melty, drippy, missing mess.
And you're less likely to back out of the polish.
It's also not involving a heat source and a flammable liquid. So.
The Tupperware jar is still made from ABS or something like that?
Yeah, you would want to make sure that you're not using a plastic that has acetone as a solvent. Tupperware tends not to use ABS as their plastic. So. The other thing is there's a new technology that a vendor called Smoothon has put on the market. Smoothon is pretty famous in the crafting scene for making a lot of materials for mold making and things like that. They put out a material called XTC3D, and this is literally where you take two chemicals, you mix them together, you brush it on with a paintbrush, it fills gaps, and it fills the gaps between layers and leaves you something that is sandable, smoothable. It looks the same way as the net result on a finished vapor smooth print, except you're actually applying it with a brush. And it's not that expensive, and it goes a really long way. I think it's like $40 for a box about this big, and I think I could probably stretch it across 100 prints about this big.
I have never tried it. Do you recommend to buy it?
I think it's worth trying at least once if you want to smooth models. It's a good technology, and it works pretty well. Especially if you want to paint afterwards, it's good to be able to do that without having to worry about the paint really bringing out the layers on the model. Because even if you sand and smooth the model, you can usually, after you paint it, you still see the layering because it comes through. With the XTC3D, it really resolves that. I'm working on a costume piece that I'm going to try and go big with the XTC3D on, so we'll see if it actually works as nice on the large scale as it did on the small for me. All right, so let's talk about the 3D printers that are out there. And we'll talk specifically with an ear towards the open hardware ones. Now, this is the sort of types of hardware that are out there right now. Stratasys and 3D Systems are the two big players in the 3D printing market. They mostly focus on the high-end scale of the market with large industrial fabrication equipment. They've been making printers since the 1970s. They're both generally pretty unfriendly to free and open source anything. They hold the majority of the patents in the space, which generally limits what other people can do, because we have ideas on how to do things, because these people have figured them out, because they've been spending the last 40 years trying to figure out ways to do things. And then anytime anybody implements one of their patents, they go out and try to collect royalties, and if they can't, they sue them into oblivion. Both vendors have support for virtually all types of 3D printing technologies. They are known for adding support for things like food, sugar, chocolate printing. So if anyone is doing revolutionary on a major scale, they're usually funded by or directly generated by one of those two companies. Now let's tell the story of MakerBot. MakerBot originally sold kits and pre-built open hardware printers that were well supported by free and open source software. The printers themselves would have been considered open hardware had the terminology existed at the time. It didn't really. They encouraged people to hack, modify, and improve their printers. They posted all the designs and schematics under open licenses, and were generally considered heroes in the 3D printing open community and the RepRap community. Until 2012. And in 2012, the people behind the company at MakerBot stopped making their hardware open. They claimed they were losing too much money to cheap knockoff Chinese versions of their printer. And they were frustrated at seeing these knockoff versions out there and decided that this would not stand and that they could not have these people making their cheap copies anymore. And so they went to make actual, real, solid, proprietary printers from then on out. Now the real story is slightly more nuanced, because the real story is that the people making MakerBot were not able to find a good model to make money off of their open printers. And the fact that they were charging way more than they needed to for the printers, and that the other companies were able to make printers that were not cheap knockoffs, but rather just as reliable as the MakerBots at a much lower price point, meant that they should have taken a harder look at how they were making money and their price points. But they went, when they went to go talk to venture capitalists, the venture capitalists said, no, stop doing that open hardware stuff. You need to start proprietarizing your printers so you can make all the money and keep all the intellectual property yourself. So MakerBot announced at the Open Hardware Summit in 2012 that they weren't going to be open hardware anymore and that we could all suck it. They didn't actually use the phrase, we can all suck it, but it was clear from the intent. They stopped providing open source software for their printers. They do still support Linux with their MakerBot printer family, but they do so with a proprietary software tool that is known to Zach. And their printers also have knocked off in quality in later years. The most recent revision of their printer, there's a class action lawsuit pending against MakerBot with the knowledge that they may have knowingly released a printer to the market that was fundamentally flawed that would never work right. Cubify. Cubify is the consumer printer that 3D Systems makes. Cubify uses proprietary filament cartridges. So if you want to buy your filament, you have to buy it from them. It literally checks the DRM signature in the cartridge to ensure that you have put in an authorized cartridge into the printer, because that's how their big printers work, so why not make their small printers work that way too? The controlling software is only available for Windows and Mac. I have seen a couple people who have bought Cubifies on sale, on discount at places, and then have spent months hacking all of this nonsense out of them, and the machine literally does not resemble anything like it started with. So many of the parts have to be changed out and modified and hacked. They probably could have been better off by just building a RepRap, but they're crazy. And this is the printer that sold at Staples, so if your parents bought you a 3D printer at Staples and you really desperately wanted to be able to run any kind of filament into it, I guess you could endeavor on such a project. But you do see it, so sometimes you'll see this printer out and about at shows and things. RepRap printers, I keep saying that term, RepRap is the project that was created to develop 3D printers that can print most of their own components. The idea being, if we can make printers, then we can have a community of people who then print other people printer parts to make their own printers and can be a self-sustaining community. And they've been pretty successful at that. They've released four designs, which are the Darwin, the Mendel, the Prusa Mendel, and the Huxley. They keep promising they're going to put out a fifth design, but they haven't done one since 2010, so...
Who are you referring as them in this case?
The official RepRap site, the one that...
Rainbow Era and stuff like that?
Yeah, I know that Joseph Prusa is effectively the RepRap community these days, and he has put out models, but he has made it clear that this is him, not the RepRap community. So he was trying to put out the models when I spoke to him last to sort of encourage the official RepRap community to either say these are now official RepRap models or to be inspired by his models. So there are newer models that he's put out there, but those are all Prusa models that are RepRap derived versus official RepRap models.
Okay.
It's a semantic difference.
Yeah.
But there are new designs that are coming out aggressively in the open hardware space, and I'll talk about a couple of the other ones a little bit later. But the RepRap project was always intended to be free software and free hardware, and they are very well supported in Linux. There's no proprietary things in the mix. The firmware that drives them is all very well known, and there's a number of different 3D printer firmwares you can choose from if you decide to design your own printer. The Lulzbot TAS is open hardware. This is one of the two printers that I have. It, in fact, is the first hardware device to receive the FSF-certified Respects Your Freedom certification. They run about $2,000, a little more than $2,000. They have the widest range of supported materials of any 3D printer on the consumer market. They like to use the term prosumer. They have an active open source community that improves and modifies the printer design. I told the story about flexible material. The open source community wanted to print NinjaFlex when the material came on the market, but every time you run it through the standard nozzle for the TAS, it clogs. Because you've got a nozzle like this, the flexible material would get into the top of the nozzle. It likes to expand when it's heated, and so it would fill that gap, and then it wouldn't push anymore. It couldn't push past it because it was too strong. So they came up with a different design with stronger motors, a direct channel drive, so there is no possibility for pooling. That's just constantly forcing the filament down now the extruder end that results in high quality. This was sort of sketched on a napkin style design by the open source community, who didn't really understand how all the motors work together in tandem. The upstream for Lulzbot started working with that community to refine that design, and then people started trying to build hacked versions of it, and then Lulzbot generate a version that they actually sell. And they released all the schematics for it open source, so if you wanted to buy the steppers and print the thing yourself, you can do it and pay them off. Current model is TAS 5. It is RepRap based, although if you put it next to other RepRap printers, it doesn't quite look the same. They have gone in different directions. This is sort of a tree off of that. It acts the same way, it just looks different. It has a 12 by 11 by 10 inch print area, which is pretty freaking huge for a printer in the RepRap family, although there are definitely bigger ones. It prints at 200 millimeters per second, which is its top speed. If you print at that speed, it is practically flying around the bed and plastic is flying everywhere, so I don't usually run it that fast, but you can if you want. It has an all-metal hot end, which can get up to 300 degrees Celsius, which allows it to print a lot of the materials that earlier printers would have had trouble doing melting for. The TAS 5 has the all-metal hot end. It also has a PEI-treated bed. PEI is polyetheramide, and basically this is a plastic sheet that you can attach to the glass, and almost all 3D printed FFF materials love to stick to it. In fact, some materials love to stick to it a little too well, like NinjaFlex, which if you don't pre-treat the PEI bed, you're never getting that NinjaFlex thing off. It's going to stick there forever.
Does it work with nylon?
Yes. Nylon, all you've got to do is put glue stick on it just to get that initial stick, and it works. It's really nice. And then Lulzbot came out with the Mini, which is also open hardware and also has the FSF certification.
Which works exceedingly well.
Yes. Now the nice thing about the Mini compared to the TAS, because it is smaller, it is slightly faster, it is 275 millimeters per second, it self-levels and it self-cleans, which is amazing. I cannot tell you how much amazing that is. It self-levels the bed. Basically, it has the all-metal hot end. It runs a slight current through the nozzle, and then it has four piezoelectric discs on each corner, and then it moves the nozzle and lowers it slowly until it just touches. To determine the row. I know, right? It's perfect. And they're making a next generation printer in the TAS family. It's probably not going to be called the TAS anymore. They're going to rebrand it. That's going to be the Mini self-leveling and self-cleaning with the TAS's flexibility and form factor. It's going to be like the perfect RepRap printer ever.
So I bought this one not only because I wanted to tease trade shows and stuff, and I wanted to be able to rep the open hardware and software because of the smaller footprint, which in that environment is important, also because for me, idiot proof is huge.
Yeah, it has a built-in handle. You can literally just pick it up with one hand, and you're like, I'm taking my printer away. As opposed to the TAS, where you kind of are.
And the self-cleaning part?
Self-cleaning part is on the back of the bed. It has a slot where you insert it's like a gritty foam almost, like a pad, and you put the pad in there, and before it prints, it brings the nozzle up to 75% heat for the job, and then runs the nozzle back and forth into this pad and scrapes off all of the extruded filament, and it comes out clean.
Okay, so it's not self-removing of the printed object.
It does not self-remove the object. That is, no one has quite gotten that, despite Hackaday's sort of hacky pushing it off with a giant. Nobody's got a self-removing from the bed yet. That's a much higher end tech that nobody is using. It is also got the PEI treated bed, so it's got the good stick. This printer runs 1350 US, which is, they can charge three times it for the quality this printer does.
It was used with someone who's used four or five different printers to print these things, and they were highly impressed by the quality.
It's a nice printer, and it's open source, and it works great in Linux. All right, the Orion Delta style printers, sometimes they're called Orion, sometimes they're called Deltas. Delta seems to be the term that's winning out now. This in the RepRap family. This is where the printer head moves in three directions. The printer head's actually attached to big rubber bands, and the motors are running on rails up the side, and so it's moving the position like this, and so that it looks like a marionette where a puppet is in the middle. The bed doesn't move, the base is fixed. This is great for printing really tall objects where moving the bed would cause it to shift just slightly and you get where the print fails as a result. So printing things like prosthetic arms that are very tall, tall bases, the Deltas do a fantastic job of printing that. The biggest downside to the Delta is they tend to have very small bases, and so if you have something that wants to be wider, then you want a different style print. Although I've seen some pretty crazy big Deltas if you really want to get into
that. I've seen the video with Delta, like, pellets.
Yeah, the 30-foot Delta that was taking the pellets, it wasn't taking filament. That's pretty crazy. I saw that in person. That was insane. This one specifically is from a vendor called CMECNC. It is also open source. It runs about $1,500. The Formlabs Form 1 is a different kind of printer. It's not an FFF printer. This is a stereolithography printer. It prints using UV-sensitive resin. So basically what it does is it directs a precise laser across the tray of resin, which causes the resin to harden where the laser intersects the resin. The build platform then rises up, and then another layer is generated, and it repeats until the model is completed. So this is different from an FFF printer, because FFF printers print bottom to top, and the SL printer with the resin prints top to bottom. So on some of the designs for the SL printer, it actually appears like the object is emerging from an ooze when it prints, which is very Terminator 2. SL technology was very patent encumbered, but the general consensus is that most of the patents in this space have either recently expired or will expire any day now. And it's very difficult to be sure of the patents because so many of them are so structured in a way that you can't tell what they're actually trying to patent. You only find out when they come after you. So when the Formlabs printer was created, they were a Kickstarter. And the Kickstarter was going fantastically well until 3D Systems came along and was like, by the way, we actually hold multiple patents, which you are infringing upon for this technology. They had a court case. They settled on the grounds that by the time the court case would be done, the patents would be expired. Formlabs agreed to not sell any printers until the patent expired and to only honor the Kickstarter and to pay a fee to 3D Systems that was equivalent to the number of printers that were successfully kickstarted. And so it was only in the last 9 months that that Formlabs has actually been able to sell 3D printers again, because they could only honor the Kickstarter. They had a store up, and you could click buy, and they'd take your money, but they couldn't send it to you until the legal terms had ended. So, It's happened. It's done. It's all done. They've started selling printers again. They're actually delivering the printers. They actually have the Form 1 Plus out now. So, the biggest downside with the Form 1 is it's a very cool printer. It prints with a very high resolution. The big downsides are that most of the resins result in a pretty fragile print. It's not going to be as solid or strong as an FFF plastic print. The other thing is that this printer is only supported on Windows or Mac. There is no Linux control software for the Formlabs Form 1. I have offered repeatedly to take their Qt-based software and port it to Linux at no charge to them under NDA, where I would literally just say, I don't even have to open source it. I will just put the binary down. You can put it on your website and offer it to people, and they have no interest. So the good news is there's a couple of, now that all the patents have expired, there's a couple of people that are building open source 3D resin printers, and there's a couple of them that are actually coming to market. There's one that's on the market called, I think it's the Muse printer, and it actually looks really reliable. It's roughly in the same price point. It actually comes out about half the cost of the Formlabs with a much bigger resin tray, so it can print bigger objects. And for resin, the people who make the Formlabs printer also make resins for it, and they've made a resin that is very strong, that is almost as strong as ABS in good prints. And they're actually using it in all sorts of crazy tests where they're like holding weights on a crane with the printed chain. And so it's actually pretty impressive. It's very expensive resin. Standard resin cost is about $149 US for a liter. The tough resin is $600 for a liter. So
it's like 20 pounds more than ABS.
Yes. But a liter goes a long way on a print. So on the low end, not the tough stuff, the liter is roughly equivalent in cost to ABS for the printing. It's not more expensive for the materials and the amount you get out of it, because the resin that doesn't get hit by the laser can be rerun through the machine. There's a lot of different ways you can do 3D printing, but almost none of them work with Linux, and they cost way, way more, and so I don't talk about them. If you want to talk about them later, I'll happily explain them to you. But it is possible to create and print 3D objects from Linux. You can do it today. Your best bet is to go with something in the RepRap family, but don't just buy a 3D printer at Staples and expect it to work with Linux. It's not going to work. Are there any questions? I'm like way over time, but I'll take some questions if you want.
I have one about the loss bot. Does it happen to you have one that ended different colors at the same time?
It's a good question. So the best way to do different colors at the same time is to have multiple nozzles. So the TAS printer, which is their bigger printer, actually has an add-on that is two nozzles. And so you can run two different colors. It is a royal pain to calibrate. Like, I have this kit and I hate using it because calibrating is so immensely difficult. And that's because you have two nozzles where when you heat one, the heat envelope affects the other nozzle. And so keeping them at a constant heat with reliable flow is almost impossible. And then the nozzles have independent height settings. And so you've got to configure it to get the heights right. And then relative to the bed, which isn't always level, it is. The last time I got it calibrated, it took me and the Lulzbot people who work for the company 3 hours to calibrate it for a single print, and it went out of calibration after the print finished. So it's hard to do dual nozzle printing in a model that's not built for it. There's a lot of people who have built custom hacks to do multi-nozzle printing in RepRap and in the Lulzbot universe, and there's even people who have built what's called a Hydra head for the Delta printers, which is 8 nozzles running on a Delta. But for the most part, if you want multiple colors, get some paint.
Yeah, I think this has more use for PVA support.
Yeah, what I really wanted to do with the dual nozzle is to be able to print a support material that would dissolve. High impact polystyrene, which we talked about briefly, is nice because it will dissolve in a chemical called limonene, which is possible to get. It's not CVS drugstore easy, but you can get it. And then the downside to that is when it dissolves, then your model smells like lemon because limonene is the chemical they use to add to thing cleaners to make it smell lemon fresh. So, any other questions? Great. Well, thank you so much for coming. I appreciate it.